Christ is risen. Alleluia. Good morning on this beautiful, beautiful day. I apologize for not getting the announcements up before now, but better late than never. We'll let those run while I'm sitting up here chatting. I can't handle changes to the schedule, so Pastor not being here just threw me off, and I can't get my act together. But anyway, some announcements for this week. Ad board meeting is not happening this week because I'll be in Vegas. It is happening next week on the 23rd, 1 o'clock for the NOW committee, 2 o'clock for the ad board. Tuesday book club is happening at 10:30. We're attempting to study Chasing Vines, that's right. So you plant your seeds and you chase the vines and see how they grow. Kind of what it's about. Gift study is happening on Friday. Pastor is back as of tomorrow. So her normal hours are in effect. The spring learning event at Four Seasons Church is Saturday at 2. I went to one last year, which was interesting. I won't be going to this one because I'll be just getting back from Vegas, so not happening. Other than that, you don't have any announcements? I didn't think so. Okay. Other than that, we can get started on the praise sings. Words will be up here.
Blessed be the Lord God.
please rise in body or spirit and join me in the call to worship. Praise God. Because of Christ's resurrection, we have been given a new life.
We have been given a secure and glorious future.
We have now gathered into Christ's presence with praise and thanksgiving.
We have come into his presence with laughter and
song. Open your heart to this hope that Christ's presence is real. Opening hymn is 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Sharing of joys and concerns. Let me check them out. Velchanupa is requesting prayers for her nephew Todd Peters. He is having heart surgery on Monday to replace his mitral valve. So we will pray for him, especially on Monday. That's the only prayer request I have, but I would encourage us all to keep the Cover family in our hearts. Shirley Cover passed away this week. And continue to keep Debbie in our hearts as she adjusts to living without a husband. And also, I have like four people I know with cancer, so let's keep cancer patients in our prayers as well, because that's just no fun. And they all need God's support. So let's sing our prayer hymn, number 452, verse 1. prayer of confession. The Lord be with you. And we join in the response. My soul is thirsting for you, O Lord, thirsting for you, my God. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where no water is. I guess I needed to say this is Psalm 63, number 788 in your hymnal. That might have helped. I have it all nicely printed, so I don't need the hymnal. So I just assumed you all knew. So shall we start over maybe, so you can be part of this? The Lord be with you. And we join with the response. My soul is thirsting for you, O Lord. Thirsting for you, my God. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where no water is.
So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory.
Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. My soul is thirsting for you, O Lord, thirsting for you, my God. My soul is feasted as with marrow and fat, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips, when I think of you upon my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night.
For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. My soul
is thirsting for you, O Lord, thirsting for you, my God. But those who seek to destroy my life shall go down into the depths of the earth. But the king shall rejoice in God. My soul is thirsting for you, O Lord, thirsting for you, my God. Please join me now in the prayer as we were taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ. Hallelujah. hung his head and prepared to die. Then lifted his face up to the sky. Said, I am coming home now, Father, to you. A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. The soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior. He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ. Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside. Now in our hearts we know he died to save us from. Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen, hallelujah.
Today's scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. Please rise in body or in spirit for this reading. Listen for the word of God through these words of scripture. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say I am?" And Simon Peter answered, You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The word of God for the people.
I visualize I'm still getting feedback. Okay. Of course, Simon Peter answers and he gives him the correct answer, doesn't he? But we know from looking at the other chapters, Peter denies him three times. And the other disciples left him. These were the people who were with Jesus through his whole entire ministry. He saw the miracles he performed and they heard the messages he gave. And yet they still left him. The question is for us today is that if these disciples that saw all that and heard what Jesus said and saw the blessings he bestowed on people, that how could they not know he was the Messiah? The question is for us this morning is how are we going to say who he is? Jesus says in the book of John, he leaves us with seven I am statements. Now, just so you know, the number seven stands for perfection or complete. So what he's saying is, I'm going to give you a complete description of who I am so that you can tell others. But for me to do that, I need to take you to the book of Exodus, chapter 3. Here we see Moses, a central character. And he was tending sheep around the Mount of Horeb for his father-in-law. Now, Moses didn't know God as God. He was raised as an Egyptian with gods of all kinds. But he was curious. So he decided this day that he was going to go to the top and find out what all the commotion was. Now, if you've seen the Ten Commandments, you know the story. But as he got there, he saw a bush burning, but it wasn't being consumed. And he was told to take his sandals off because he was on holy ground, which he did. But the strange thing is that God said, Moses, Moses. He knew who Moses was. And he says to Moses, I hear the prayers of those in Egypt that are suffering, and I'm going to have you go and bring them out. Now, Moses was raised with a powerful Egyptian army, and you can imagine what was going through his mind, like being asked to give the message. Gave him all kinds of excuses, but God told him, I'm going to be with you. But he still didn't understand or hear. Finally, the last question from Moses was, when I go to them and they ask me who sent me, what am I to say? And God says, I am the I am. I am the I am. Think about that moment. No matter what you would say about God, he is. Isn't that true? So what we got here now is this I am statement. And you can see that the I am is not the same as what Jesus was asking. This I am was so sacred that the Jews would not utter it. They wouldn't even put it in writing, to the point that even today they don't know how to pronounce the word I am. Now, can you imagine Jesus going to these people in the hierarchy of the church and saying, I am? Where he's saying is, I am God, or equal to God. The first one we're going to do, or I'm going to cover, is in chapter 6 of John. And I ask you to write down these verses and go back and look at the whole chapter, because the chapter will explain a lot more than I can. For these I am statements should be done in a Bible study to where you can talk more about it. The first one is in John 6:35, and it says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Now, Jesus uttered these words after he fed the 5,000. A physical demonstration of his power. But was it his power? He goes on to tell them that God supplied the manna. It came from heaven for their hunger. He provided. And we can look at it and say the same thing about Jesus. He came from heaven, and he was provided with the ability to spread the word of God. In the book of book of Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says that blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Unlike the manna that was brought for the food of the body, Jesus was come for the soul of the individuals. He was both human and godlike. But because of the feeding of 5,000, you can interpret this that whatever he offers is abundant, transformative, and never exhausted. John 8:12. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me won't walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Certainly we know how dark is and how uneasy we are around darkness, aren't we? Instead of being brave men, and forgo the flashlight, we like to fumble around and find our way. And we end up stubbing our toe, don't we? But this is the image that Jesus has given us about him. The darkness he talks about is not the darkness of night, but the darkness of sin in people's lives. The refusal of those who don't take the time to learn about Jesus and God. They walk around in sadness, and Jesus is saying that I am the light. If you search for me, I will be there. The light was created by God on the first few days, actually the first day, and people question me about that, but Jesus brought light into the world, and he looked at the Pharisees and the Sadducees who could not see what it meant to serve God and said they were blind. Now, it was this I am statement that the Pharisees and those in power decided to put Jesus to death. That was their first day, because Jesus, just before that, took spittle and dirt and made clay and put on the blind man's eyes. And he told them, go to the pool of Siloam and cleanse your eyes. And the blind men saw. When the Pharisees and that questioned Jesus, he said, the man was blind and now can see. You can see, but you are blind. Which didn't set too well. The next one, I'm out of order here. Excuse me. Next one is, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep, which is in John chapter 10, verse 11. We who are in the church have heard the Psalms 23, where David talks about, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me beside the still waters." Notice what he said, "My Lord led me." The Eastern Shepherd was always walking in front, and his sheep who knew him would follow wherever he went. That's the image that Jesus is trying to say, that he is your shepherd. If you follow him, he will lead you beside the still waters. He will be sure that your soul is fed. Being a shepherd, he was telling you that I have humility and passion for those that I have been given. The other one he talks about is the sheep gate. Now, we here in northern Indiana do not know what a sheep gate is. And it's buried in this idea in Scripture about the shepherd. Now, the sheep gate was a gate on the side of the city that allowed the shepherd to lead his sheep into the city as while the doors of the city are closed after dark. Jesus said, "I am the gate." What he is saying is that he guards the sheep. He allows them to go in and out. So the sheep were being cared for by God. But the shepherd comes to the gate and calls his sheep, and they come. Just his sheep. But if you look at that scripture, he says, "I have other sheep to get, to come back and get." That's us, folks. John 15:5. "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, then you will produce much fruit." Again, John 15:5. Now, for a gardener, this is quite obvious. But this is the one I am statement where he puts all three together. God, the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We need Jesus in our life to be fed so that we can produce good fruit. He goes on in that chapter and explains about how we Gentiles will be grafted into the body. It explains the idea of the community of the church. The next one is a little bit difficult, so we're not going to go in too deep in it. Because the end of it is, I always get a question about that. And here I'll read it to you, and you'll know why I always get questions. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." We could go on forever discussing that. Well, what about Joe Blow that has been a good man all of his life? I don't know. All I know is what Scripture tells us. And the Scripture tells us that God sent his Son to be a sacrifice for us. That's it. And if you go on and read the book of Revelation, it shows you that God will not satisfy until everybody has the opportunity to get the kingdom of God. This part of this I am statement is taken in the middle of chapters 14 through 17, which they call it the farewell discourse, which is where Jesus gave his final testimony, his final say-so before he was buried. And to begin with that, it says, "Do not let your heart be troubled." For he knew that his disciples were concerned. He's telling them that I have to go. I have to leave you. But I prepare a place for you. But I'll be back for you. That in itself should be so rewarding to us, isn't it? That in our days of end, when our life is over, He will be there to lead us to the promised land. He will comfort us like a shepherd. He will care for us because he gave up his life for each of us. But notice what he says, you can only get there through me. The same thing with the gate, the sheep's gate. You, to get to the Lord God, you have to go through Jesus. And he leads his sheep in and out and cares for them. That's the image that we have to keep. So often in a Bible study, everybody brings up the Old Testament and says, we don't need the Old Testament anymore. You can only kill so many people. But in the Old Testament, it prepares us for this. It prepares us for Jesus. The whole idea of a shepherd and him coming to share with us. The bread of life and light. The next one is in 11:25. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Can you guess where he said these words? Well, he says it to Shara's favorite person, Martha. Now you remember the story of Lazarus who was ill, and 2 or 3 days before, Jesus was informed that he was ill and probably dying. And Jesus waited. And as he went to the city 2 days later, Martha meets him and says, Lord, if you were here, Lazarus surely wouldn't die. And Jesus tells him, don't you believe? Haven't you heard me? And what's he do? He calls Lazarus out. Lazarus, come. And everybody's concerned because by now he should be smelling. And that's what it says. But Jesus knew. And then he told Martha, I am the resurrection. He was telling him about his own life. He dies, but he is resurrected to a new life. He has that power. And guess what? He gives that power to each of us. For the sound of the trumpet, it says that we will all be resurrected. Even those who are dead in the grave will rise. That those who are saved will be with him in heaven. I don't know about you, but that's kind of rewarding. Now, when I first read, when Jesus was asking these disciples the question, I overlooked the whole thing. I did not see what Jesus was trying to tell us. But if you read Matthew 24, you will see that everybody will be saying to you, well, Jesus is here, or Jesus is there, or Jesus is this, or Jesus is that. What saves us by being involved with the Antichrist? That's why I like Bible studies, because somebody could say, I know. Knowing who Jesus is. We can say Jesus was humble and sent by God to save me from my sins. I struggled with church almost all my life and probably until I was 35. And I wish I could say then that it just bright light came and all of a sudden things were different. That I saw the big picture. I could stand up and preach to you, which I was glad they changed it to message. Because the first time I would ask to give the message, I said, there's no way I can give somebody the message. My language isn't right. But there were people in the church who knew who God was that worked with me through all this period of time. And I got to tell you, I was in my 40s until I got the big picture. And I got the big picture by hungering and thirsting for the Word of God with the help of people in this church. So I ask you, when you have your time, is to join a Bible study and learn who Jesus really is. Because I can tell you, all that we've covered here this morning, there's tons more to be seen by those. I can tell you, when they talk about in Scripture, when they looked at Jesus, they saw something, they just didn't know what it was. They heard him speak in dynamic to where 5,000 people could hear him speak. We need mics. They saw something in his eyes when they looked at him. They saw somebody that loves me. Jesus was humble, except when he drove out the people from the temple. He didn't like that. For one thing, they did not understand who God was and what God wanted. God wanted each and every one of you to be part of the kingdom of God. And he will do everything in his power out of love to bring you to the temple. He will open up the darkness in your life to the light if you only let him. He'll bring the food by his words to satisfy your soul, that, and the Holy Spirit will be working in your life so that you never thirst. Remember the story of the lady by the Jacob's well, when he told her that he had the water, the spring of the water, where he was saying, and she didn't understand, you don't even have a bucket. How are you going to get this water? He said, well, if I give you this water, you'll never be thirsty again. Of course, she said, give it to me. That's what God offered when he sent Jesus here. Because those who were running the church had no clue what God wanted out of them. If you look at the laws that they put forth to put over people, was over 6,000 volumes. Think about that. Not little bitty ones, but volumes of what you can do and what you can't do. They put such a burden on people that you misunderstood who God was. Jesus says, if you see me, you see the Father. I always visualized when I was complaining about church, that I always visualized God being on that judge's stool with that black robe. And as I approached, he said, okay, you're out. Bringing up all my sins, and I said, well, I don't need that. That's why Jesus said, I am. I'm the message from God that I love you and I'm willing to do everything to have you understand that God loves you just as you are. Jesus, by using the I am statements, tells us that he is the way of eternal life and communion with God and all God's creation. We have a job to do, folks. If you read your scripture, you will see that we have a task almost equal to Jesus. And Jesus said, you will accomplish more than I have accomplished. You read that and say, oh yeah, right. But Jesus had to have his disciples to understand what he represented, because the message of God had to go everywhere. Even us today. The light reminds us that Jesus is fully divine and the one that God sent for us with a holy purpose. He gave us an example of how we should live our lives. The self-sacrifice, and not just to give up your life, but give up your life for the service of those who are in the church with us. Love them as they were part of your life. The bread reminds us that Jesus is fully human, born at a particular time and place to offer nourishment to our soul. His words are so refreshing when you look at it from the eyes of light and not the eyes of darkness. To look at Scripture as a way forward and not condemning. To look at the Scripture that Jesus talked about, that God loves you and will do anything to set you free. The Good Shepherd and the gate bring both divine and human together to offer guidance, protection, and purpose. The vine connects us into Jesus' life and mission. We have a mission to carry the Word of God to everybody, to make disciples of Christ, to let them know through us, you can see God. Now I'm sure, at least me, I don't want somebody to look at me to see God. But it says that he will work with us, he will mold us into doing his work. The way points us to the way of suffering and the blessed grace that is redeemed. He doesn't expect you to be beat like he was. He doesn't expect you to wear the crown of thorns and bleed. He doesn't expect you to carry the cross through all those streets in Rome. But he does ask you to self-sacrifice. Look after the ones that need it the most. Think about those who are in need, not only in the church. We don't really know who's all in the church, do we? The only thing we know is the people who sit here in Trinity. But there are people who are a part of Christ and God's church who don't go to church. That's the light we have to spread. The final I am is that Jesus gave up his life and rose in 3 days. Because God loved us, and so did he. He had to suffer all the penalties he did. The worst of was of being ignored by God when he died upon the cross. You and I don't have to suffer that, folks. For when that time comes, Jesus will be there to guide you home as the Good Shepherd. That's the promise. That's the thoughts that we have to carry. That's a title that we have to give them. We serve a God, an I am God, that was sent from heaven to save each and every one of us. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for the blessing you've given each of us. Help us, Father, by sending the Holy Spirit upon us that we can search for what Jesus wants us to know. To know fully that he came with a purpose and that we as his sheep should join in that practice. Through him we have eternal life. Through him we have a message that God is with us in everything that we do. That's the thing that Moses forgot, that God will be with him in his tasks. Jesus offers that. Where you are, God is with you. Where two or three, he would be there with us. So we ask all that in the blessed name of Jesus. And God the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you very much, Mel. And now it's time to give thanks to our Lord with our morning offering. Ushers.
Thank you.
Please rise for the doxology. Generous God, you always give to each of us the best. We thank you for this opportunity to share from our abundance. Bless these gifts that we offer to you. May they be used toward the ministries and mission of this church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Closing hymn is number 469, all verses. Close out our service, let's join together in our breakthrough prayer. Because faith moves mountains. Almighty, loving, and powerful God, we know that you are with us. I surrender my whole self to you in faithfulness, no matter the circumstances. Together we pray, renew and revive Trinity United Methodist Church, unleashing new life. Break through and open doors of dreams, hopes, and possibilities. Give us the faith and courage to step through the doors you open that will lead us far beyond all that we could ask or imagine. And Lord, your will, not ours. Amen. Go forth this week sharing God's love. Everyone in the world needs to see Jesus' light shining through you. Have a great week.